We're back with MCP Connects, and today we're in beautiful San Diego, California, to connect with our good friend, Jon Foreman. He joins us from the Switchfoot studio, and today he talks about life in quarantine and how Switchfoot is choosing to embrace the chaos and create positivity. He also plays and dedicates a beautiful song to our rock stars and hospitals around the world. Here we go! Joining us from the Switchfoot studio in San Diego, California, Jon Foreman. Jon, so good to see you, man.
Good to see you too, Levi.
Thank you so much for making time. I know things are crazy. You guys are pivoting. You're doing shows. You're figuring out how to survive and sustain. Thank you for making the time to just connect.
Oh, man, I'm honored to connect with you, and it's good to see your smile. It's been too long.
Yes. Well, man, that's nowadays... to the value of a smile has gone up so far, you know, like to be able to see the face and the smile and that expression of joy. It's important.
Exactly. I do find that in this season where many things are taken away, you value what you have. You value what you might not have understood the value of before, yeah. You know?
Well, no question. And there's, you know, I mean, speaking of value, that's one of the beauties of this incredibly difficult circumstance, right, is that we're recognizing just how remarkably blessed we are and appreciating the small things that we so often take for granted, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I see the Love Loud megaphone in the background there. Yes. Dude, I still have mine.
Do you? Yeah. I love it. That's
my
awesome.
My daughter used it for a lemonade stand, you know, so it has a practical purpose around the house.
Perfect. It's out there. It's getting love from the daughter. That's huge.
Yeah, that's it.
Well, man, I love the space. I feel like I'm in like the Switchfoot yellow submarine. It's incredible.
Yes, this is we have entered into the quarantine thinking we can either brace against it or we can embrace. And so we are choosing to just embrace, and we're saying, well, let's take people on an adventure. Let's continue to keep our entire team family employed. And we're going to be doing live streams every month. And some of them are going to be from this space. It's super fun. Actually, this right here, that is a portal to another world.
So another dimension.
We'll go there some other time, but yeah.
Man, I love it. So one of the things I'll never forget, you played our gala, right, a couple years ago. And one of the things you said to me that evening was embrace the chaos, you know? And it's, I think we have this crazy misconception that we control things here, you know, that we have some say over the way things are going to go, or that we have, that there's stability. And I think if anything, what COVID has taught us is we don't control things, and to a certain degree, you have to let go and find peace in that chaos. So thank you for that statement, but how are you finding peace, and how are you staying engaged and upbeat and positive through all this?
Yeah, it is a strange time because many of the substrates of meaning, many of the scaffoldings that we were crawling our way up on have fallen or shattered or disappeared. And so that can be a really hopeless position when a lot of the things that you've worked really hard for are crumbling. And yet I think it's also an incredibly hopeful place where you have this new opportunity to actually invest in things that might be eternally significant. And that I feel like this season for me has been, there's certainly mourning where I'm there's so much to mourn in our nation. I think that there's so many deep scars and wounds, and the past is coming to light in necessary ways. And yet it's not a pretty time, sure, you know, that sure. I hope that we can come through this a better nation. I hope that we can come through this better families, and running to things that actually can continue to sustain us rather than just kind of slapping band-aids on these issues. But yeah, for me, I have to kind of put myself into some sort of a schedule, because otherwise I just find myself on the news all the time.
Yes.
Oh my gosh, we're all gonna die. True, we're all gonna die, but not yet, you know.
No, that's true, man. There's a new we coined a new phrase during the course of this that I just heard yesterday. It's called doom scrolling. And I'm like,
yes.
Oh man, that's so, yeah. You know, like you say, I think there's something, the outcome from this is the one that we choose, I think, you know,
yeah.
And do we choose that this divides us more and separates us more and gives us more reason for division and to look at the differences in each other? Or do we choose that this is our, maybe a little bit of a wake up call and a little bit of a recognition of what is truly important, and that's people, that is relationships, that is hearts and reaching out and connecting. You know, I mean, it's one of the things that I love and appreciate about you, about Switchfoot. I feel like what you guys do is so much more than entertainment. There's purpose behind it, and your shows have this sense of an intention where you're bringing people together and you're sharing in this joy and a positive message. What's something from this experience that you'll take with you out of this, you know, as you go back into performance?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, so much of what I do live is currently unavailable.
Sure.
High fives, hugs, everyone put your arm around the person next to you, you know, it's like, oh yeah, that's actually unsafe. We did a drive-in concert. We actually were the first concert in California to safely happen after the lockdown, which felt like we were able to raise money for a noble cause down here, Feeding San Diego. But it was also, I think music is an important part of the human experience, you know, so to be able to play live music safely felt meaningful. But I was just realizing, all the things that I normally do during a show aren't really available. I had to sign a contract that said I would not go off the stage.
Oh no.
You know, for obvious reasons. It makes
sense. Yeah, sure, yeah. But like, I mean, you say, I mean, you've, you know, I mean, of all the bands, I mean, I know there's a lot of bands that tour a lot, but you guys are warriors. You're out there touring so often. And like you say, I'm sure it's just become an extension of yourself to connect with people in that way and bring them together and have that. So how does that feel?
It's a strange thing. But I do find that music still has a power to connect even while we're apart. And that's kind of been our goal. We have a Hemingway quote that I painted. It hasn't made it back to its normal spot up there, but it says, "Now is no time to think of what you do not have. Think of what you can do with what there is." Hmm. And so that has been my mantra for this time. Think of what you can do with what there is. Don't think of what you do not have. Because there's so many things that we could lament about. But the beauty is, even like, I think my job is to bring people together. And so that's just my job description. And and so now, even though we can't be physically together, we can still be brought together. I think that has a deep, deep purpose for our nation and our planet. And I'm still taking my job seriously, trying to do that.
Yeah.
You know? And I think I definitely have been inspired by you guys. We've done several events with you guys, certainly your benefit concert, but two other shows where strangely, we have now entered into your reality in ways that I would have never dreamed, you know?
Well, man, I mean, yeah, we were talking about it a little bit before, you know, kind of the interview started, but that we've all kind of, maybe that's the portal to what these kids are experiencing. And we've all stepped through that portal, and these kids and these families that have been dealing with isolation, have been dealing with that sense of loneliness and being set apart and having to find their way, they feel on their own, you know, through these scary and anxious times. We've all kind of entered that space that they are the rock stars of, like they are the heroes of this space, you know?
Yeah.
So I think, like you say, there's incredible power in music and not just music, but music and intention, when you're reaching out with that purpose to bring people together, to bring love, to bring empathy and understanding and say, hey, I'm here, I'm standing with you, you know? And I've seen you do it in such a way, man. I don't know if you know this, but you gave a quote at the first show that we live streamed together, and I've repeated that in almost every show since. And it's just that as you were calling out to the kids, you were saying your story matters. Your struggle is important, and we're here and we see you and we're thinking about you. And there's such power in that, you know? So thank you.
No, man. I mean, I think meaning and purpose in pain are crucial in finding a way through it. You know, I mean, the interesting thing is there no story that you tell that is any good is without pain or sacrifice. Like,
right.
You tell me about your vacation where nothing goes wrong, it's a horrible story. It's a great vacation, but it's a horrible story. Now you tell me about the time like your car lost a wheel and you were 4 days out, you know, in the desert trying to find hitchhike back home. That's a great story. You know what I mean? And so I think like when I think about these kids, I think like, man, they are living these incredible stories. I hope they know that because the things that you get cheaply are cheap. And the things that cost you are the things that actually are worth paying for, you know? My daughter, we've been to the hospital a lot, and I'm not going to tell her story, but my heart goes out to all the parents out there that, you know, that are continually going down to the emergency room. I know what that's like, and that it's this thing where you gladly trade places, but you can't. But I keep thinking about my daughter and I think, man, she is so incredible. She's my hero in a lot of ways, you know, where I look at her and her strength, I'm like, oh, someday I hope to have that strength.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's been a true perspective check, you know, with these kids and with these families. And what we've seen so often is the intent obviously was to reach out and try to provide something to them in the midst of difficult times, you know, but the reality is so often it's going the other way. And they've taught us so much about joy in the midst of pain and sorrow and suffering. And that happiness and joy are not the same thing. You can be joyful and happy at the same time, but you can be joyful and suffering at the same time. And joy is something so much deeper and more significant than happiness, you know? And they've taught us about that, the power of true joy. And again, that them and their situations they are in, all of a sudden, all of the insignificant things of life just kind of melt away, you know, your car or your house or your, you know, your social media account or whatever. And it really comes down to each other and connecting on that deeper level and finding that fulfillment in relationship, you know, and it's incredibly powerful.
That's huge. If any of the kids are watching this, obviously we can't hug each other for a million reasons, but I just want to give you guys a hug. I'm just like, give you encouragement and say, you know, just how proud I am to know you, I know a couple of you. We've had the privilege of getting to know a couple of the kids through you, Levi, and then through my daughter, and the communities that develop around these kids are just so beautiful because I think, like you said, they are forced to be focused on the things that truly matter and everything else just disappears.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, man, and you know, speaking of focusing on those things, you guys, like I say, have been really intentional about using your music and your platform as this kind of force for good, you know. And I know in the last couple shows that you guys have done, the live stream shows, you've connected with a couple of rock stars, with Tigi and with Faith. And
yes.
I have to say, I've had conversations with them afterwards and it's just made such an impact, you know. And Faith specifically has been having a hard go. It's been a rough couple of months, you know, and we've been talking back and forth, and she sent me a picture a couple weeks ago about kind of where she was, her emotional state. And then a few days after that, you guys connected with her, you played a show, You shared some love with Faith. You are sending her your ukulele, which is unbelievable.
I have the privilege of bringing our friend Faith from Minneapolis, Twin Cities, right here into the room. Faith is a ukulele player. She's a piano player. And I told her we have to make sure that we get her one of my ukuleles. So that you, next time we come through the Twin Cities, can you please join us on stage? Maybe you can help me. Maybe you can teach me some chords.
I've got a better one. I got a brand new one sent to me that we're gonna sign and get and give to her, because mine's all covered with scratches and everything. And I was like,
it's a performance sweat.
Yeah, I talked to my friend at Gretsch, and they're like, "Oh, we're on it."
That's so cool, man. Well, she sent me
music. If she can play, mean, if that gets me through some crazy times. If she can use that vehicle to get to other places, you know, what gift?
Absolutely. Well, and she sent me a picture during that concert, and her whole countenance had just completely shifted. You know, so you were able to reach in to the midst of that really difficult time and just provide that hope, you know, that completely shifted her whole experience and her whole perception of the experience. And she said her brother was in the background, who's a huge, huge fan of Switchfoot, you know, just like, I can't believe this is happening right now. I can't believe it. So I'm so grateful for what you guys have done and the heart that you display in doing your, you know, in living out your mission.
Well, thank you for letting us come alongside of you guys and join you in your incredible, just heroic quest. I think of, like, you know, like some sort of Knights of the Round Table quest, you know, just go out and make the world a better place. I love what you guys do.
So appreciated, man. So tell me, what is, because you were going to be a pro surfer, right? That was, and you are a phenomenal surfer, but you had a moment, something shifted and you did music. Was there, what is your most profound music memory? You know, was there something about music that that connected just on a deeper level?
Well, first of all, I don't know that I don't know that I could have ever made it as a pro surfer. I love surfing. I surf competitively and everything, but it's basically only the top like 4 or 5 pro surfers that actually can pay their mortgage anyway. So I would definitely not be on that list. There, for me, music, surfing is this incredible release and outlet, and you're connected. You're looking out the infinite, and you are. I think it, you know, you talk about the chaos and the lack of control. Certainly the ocean can remind you that you're not in control. And music is a different entrance into that chaos. I think it's almost a vehicle for me in junior high was really tough for me. And, we moved schools. I didn't have any friends and, you know, literally no one. And I developed a stuttering problem, and music was this place where I could say things I couldn't say anywhere else. And I could hear someone else say something that I had no words for. And it felt like this way to, not escape from reality, but actually enter into the fullness of reality in a way that I couldn't, you know. In, And ever since then, in junior high, I've kind of been, music has been that place for me where I can find meaning and look for meaning and connect with my maker and fight with God in the same medium. You know, I think that all of those things and questions and doubts and fears and hopes, and music has this way of getting it out that I've never found anywhere else.
Yeah, that's powerful. I mean, I think I love the idea that it's not escape, it's entering more deeply, you know, because I think escapism is a huge thing that we do, you know. So rather than trying to do that, trying to embrace it more wholeheartedly is huge. Do you have, you know, in all your years of playing and the way that it has helped you enter more fully into reality, do you have a word that you can sum music up in? One word.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, maybe joy. I think that the fear is a horrible fuel for your engine, and joy is a wonderful fuel. I think you can even find the joy of expression can help you sing a song of pain, that even a painful song, you find joy in the expression of that pain. You find joy and beauty and truth in someone else pouring their heart out. The painful situation has not changed. You know, it is still painful. It is still raw and difficult, but that it kind of gives you leverage that allows you to find, dig yourself out and find a perspective other than underneath the weight of it.
Yeah.
So yeah, joy would probably be my word.
Yeah. That's a really good one. And also I think, like you say, fear is not a good fuel. But it is prevalent. There's a lot of it out there, you know?
I feel like that is, yeah, that is our fear, anger, hatred, intolerance. That these are all words I would express at the time we're living in, you know? And
yeah.
I had a friend of mine who's a psychologist say that a lot of kids and adults too, like when you reach into the grab bag of emotion, when you're afraid, anger is the first thing that you pull out, you know? So that's why when somebody cuts you off of the freeway, you don't, your first response isn't like, oh, they probably are distracted. And I've been distracted. I know what that's like. And they're probably having a bad day. Maybe they're going to the hospital. They could be, right. You know, your first response is just, what are you doing? You know, like anger, because it's the first thing that comes out. And I feel like, I've been trying to take a breath, take a beat, take a moment and dig in and grab a different emotion. Cause I think, yeah, that anger comes out quickly, but I don't know that it often does any good, you know, when it's expressed, unless it's expressed with incredible eloquence and grace towards the person, you know, I don't do that very well.
anger and eloquence don't typically come in the same, not the same hand.
Yeah.
But man, speaking of, you know, of joy being that good fuel and being that alternative to fear and anxiety and all of those things, and yet being able to balance fear and anxiety with joy. Do you have a song to bring some joy to these kids and these families? And do you have some names that you want to dedicate this song to?
Yes. Okay. So this is a song that I wrote years ago in a dark time. I think for me, I write songs when I'm frustrated, discouraged, depressed, angry, and when I'm happy, I go surfing. So this is a song that I'd like to dedicate to Jonathan in Washington, to Carly in Kansas, to Parker in Washington, to Samantha in California, to Kira in Vermont, to Tigi in Kansas. We love you, Tigi. And Faith, what's happening? It's good to play another song for you. I also want to dedicate this one to all the kids watching at Seacrest Studios, to George Mark Children's in California, New York Presbyterian, and Upstate Golisano Children's Hospital. This is a song that goes like this. Welcome to the planet. Welcome to existence. Everyone's here. Everyone's here. Everybody's watching you now. Everybody waits for you now. What happens next? What happens next? I dare you to move. I dare you to move. I dare you to lift yourself up off the floor. I dare you to move. I dare you to move. happened before. Welcome to the fallout. Welcome to resistance. The tension is here. The tension is here. It's between who you are and who you could be. It's between how it is and how it should be. Yeah. I dare you to move. I dare you to move. I dare you to let yourself up off the floor. I dare you to move. I dare you to move. Like today never happened. Today never happened. Maybe redemption, the stories to tell. Maybe forgiveness is right where we fell. Where can we run to escape from ourselves? Where are we gonna go? Where are we gonna go? Yeah, where are we gonna go? Where we gonna run to now? I dare you to move. I dare you to move. I dare you to lift yourself. To lift yourself up out the floor. I dare you to move. I dare you to move. Yeah. Like today never happened. Today never happened.
Yes. Oh, John, that's beautiful, man. And maybe the perfect song right now, just to move to that place of joy and empathy and love for each other. Like we said, I think the outcome is what we choose in the midst of all of this.
Yeah, and I'm taken back to when I wrote that song. I was singing to myself, you know, like, what does it take to like rise from these emotions and the situation that I can't change, but the feelings and the way I treat each other that I can, you know, where you're like, okay, where do we go from here? All right, let's go, let's do it. You know, how do we get there? So if I could send a message to all those kids out there, keep going, keep going. Keep fighting. We are with you. You're not alone.
Thanks so much for tuning in. If you're a musician and would like to join us in supporting hospitalized kids, email us at rockstar@melodiccaring.org. I'm Levi Ware, and this is the Melodic Caring Project.